Hey, it's Chris, back with some more iPad Pro content. Today, I want to help you decide between the Magic Keyboard and the new Logitech Combo Touch. Now, just so you know, I've got lots of iPad content coming. I'm actually working with some app developers to come up with some really great tests to show off the new iPad Pro. That's taking some time, but it's coming up. So get subscribed if you want to go in depth and try to push the iPad Pro to its limits with me. But I know a lot of people's orders are starting to arrive, and I know the next question for a lot of you is which keyboard? So of course I've got the new Magic Keyboard here, which is kind of the de facto keyboard for the iPad Pro. Amazing typing experience, but does have some limitations. And also, it's quite a bit more expensive than the Logitech Combo Touch. The Combo Touch here starts at $199 for the smaller iPad Pro. For the 12.9 inch that I'm testing here, it's $229.99. By way of contrast, the Magic Keyboard starts at $299 for the smaller iPad and goes up to $349. So you're gonna save over $100 if you opt to go with this Logitech. Now, I've covered the Logitech Combo Touch before in its previous iteration, and it was good, but it had some things that needed to change in order for it to improve. And I'm happy to report that there have been some noticeable improvements this year. Number one, while it's actually still quite protective, Logitech has managed to shrink the overall footprint of the bumpers here, and I noticed it immediately when I put the new iPad Pro in, just how much thinner the overall package actually is now. But number two, and much more importantly, in my book, this trackpad has improved quite a bit. Because in the previous version, you couldn't actually press down and click in the top corners or along the top there. So before, you had to come down into the mid and bottom area to actually do a press to select something. And the workaround that a lot of people ended up using was going into their settings and enabling tap to click, which was fine. I mean, it was usable. And I gotta tell you, those two changes have made a world of difference in how I perceive this product and my likelihood to really feel like recommending it. One thing I wanna know is that while this trackpad has been massively improved, one thing I did immediately after getting this set up, and setup is very easy, it uses a smart connector, so just by putting it in the case, it's paired and ready to go. But the first thing I did was go into settings, general, trackpad, and I raised that trackpad speed all the way up to the top, and that made it much more enjoyable for me to use, because when I first paired it, that tracking speed was really slow. So what we're going to explore throughout this video is kind of compare and contrast the use cases, because the use cases I feel like are the main thing here, rather than really the features even. And I just want to help you decide, is it worth getting the Apple product because it's the Apple product, paying that premium, even though you end up missing out on things like a row of function keys here on the Magic Keyboard, which you do actually have here, which is really nice, or should you save some money and put up with some of the limitations that the Combo Touch itself presents? And actually, I should mention, this older model of Combo Touch that I have here did not have inverted T arrow keys. The new version absolutely does, so that's nice. If you're fidgeting around and not looking down at the keyboard, you're able to just know which arrow key is what based on touch. And that's the same situation that you have on the Magic Keyboard as well. They both have inverted T arrow keys, so that's nice. Now let me just get something out of the way right off the bat. I've been saying over and over and over again, I sound like a broken record here on this channel, that the Magic Keyboard is my favorite typing experience for the iPad Pro, and that is still true. What I'm talking about are the actual key presses. Nothing beats them. I love the way that Apple has manufactured the keyboard here. That said, the keyboard on the Combo Touch is actually really nice itself, to the point where I feel like it's about 90 to 95% as good, as enjoyable of a typing experience, the actual key presses, as the Magic Keyboard, which is pretty high praise. Logitech does have a lot of experience manufacturing keyboards. The MX Keys, for example, is one of my favorite keyboards ever. And so a lot of that expertise shows up here. Great typing experience. Now let me rotate these and show you guys the trackpad. The trackpad is much larger on the Combo Touch than it is on the Magic Keyboard. Now in this case, is bigger better? Obviously, this is better than last year's Combo Touch trackpad. Absolutely, hands down. I would upgrade from the last one to this one just for that. But nothing beats the Magic Keyboard's trackpad either. When you click, it's just so enjoyable. And not only that, but the actual swiping and the gestures, they just seem to register better, a little bit smoother, just more intuitively over here on the Magic Keyboard than they do on the trackpad on the Logitech Combo Touch. And actually, I feel like the Combo Touch's trackpad is maybe 80% as enjoyable as the Magic Keyboards. Now, if all we were going on was purely the typing experience and that trackpad experience, then without a doubt, I would recommend getting the Magic Keyboard because I think those features really are just a notch above. But that's not the end of the story. We have to talk about form factor. And that's where things get a little more complicated here because I feel like the Magic Keyboard is truly a go anywhere keyboard. What I mean by that is I can grab my iPad mounted on the Magic Keyboard here and I can put it on the desk and get to work there, take it to the coffee shop, get to work there. And importantly, I can sit down on a chair or a couch, or even I could type on this when I'm in bed and put it on the lap and actually have it be usable. And that is really just down to the design. It's a very rigid design. And so the iPad is not gonna go anywhere. The base is nice and stable. And it's heavy because of that too. But the Combo Touch does some interesting things. Because of its Microsoft Surface style kickstand here, you can really adjust the viewing angle to be just about anything that you want. Whereas the Magic Keyboard is kind of stuck at what, 130 degrees? And on top of that, the keyboard is detachable. So if you just want to use this as a stand and you want to watch a video, maybe some YouTube, some Netflix, or you want to do some gaming and you don't want this just hanging out being in the way, then the Combo Touch is absolutely killer for those applications. And I'll tell you what else. I really like it for Sidecar. If you're a big Sidecar user, I actually don't like using Sidecar with my Magic Keyboard because the keyboard doesn't get out of the way. I can't detach it. And it's just sitting there taking up space on the desk. So as someone who's been using the Magic Keyboard since it came out pretty much all the time, it's really refreshing to be able to yank that keyboard off and just use this as a stand. So if you use the Apple Pencil a lot, you can just rip this off and put this down and open up Apple Notes or Procreate or whatever you're getting into and get to work. And it's just a real nice experience. The bumper really doesn't get in the way when you're writing. And so I like that a lot. Now, honestly, which is more work or less work, taking off the keyboard and laying that on the desk or taking the iPad off your Magic Keyboard, setting that to the side and getting to work and then having to mount it back on your Magic Keyboard? I don't know. There's a little extra work in both workflows. Really not sure which one's better, but hey, check out this cool case from Elago that I bought and finally arrived in. I'm using it for the first time in this video, and I got a little bit of Apple Pencil swag happening. And while we're talking about the Apple Pencil, let me just mention the iPads that I've already received are review units, and I'm waiting to stick my paper-like on my personal iPad Pro because I don't have to send it back, and I want to keep that paper-like on. I don't want to have to remove it. I know a lot of people are asking about that. Are you going to put the paper-like on the 12.9? I definitely am, and I can't wait to do it. But I'm going to show you guys what it's like to have the paper-like on the 12.9 inch. Now, there is a major downside when it comes to the Combo Touch's design. The second that you stick it on your lap and try to type, you realize it's just not going to work. You just can't quite balance it, and that's why this keyboard really isn't a go anywhere keyboard. So as you're considering these, you really need to ask yourself, do you need something that's more protective, more rugged? If you're gonna be throwing this in a backpack a lot and you're worried about the edges of your iPad getting scraped up or maybe worse, then the protection afforded by the Combo Touch is definitely better. Also, if you find that it's too much of a pain to get into your control center here to change the volume, and you would rather just have dedicated volume buttons or the ability to skip tracks without having to talk to Siri, for instance, or just adjust your brightness, your contrast, if you need those buttons, if you like those buttons, it's great to have them here within easy reach. Personally, while I used to really gripe about that on the Magic Keyboard, I have found that it's not too bad to just get in here to control panel and control all that same stuff. Sometimes with more options, like if you're playing music, you can long press and get the album art and some additional information, for instance, versus just skipping the track with a button. So I don't know, there's really pros and cons for that too. The other thing that you need to ask yourself is how much do you need this passive charging capability that the Magic Keyboard offers you, which in turn frees up the new Thunderbolt port on these new iPad Pros, or are you okay with when you're charging, you don't have the ability to use any accessories with that Thunderbolt port? I mean, this is the iPad Pro, and Thunderbolt could be a very big deal depending on what your workflow is. And it could be a shame to end up having that blocked. personally, I kind of feel like that's a deal killer for me with the Combo Touch. I'm just talking about my personal workflow. Yours could be totally different because I'm really looking forward to grabbing this Samsung Drive, which I'll link up down below for you to fully take advantage of those Thunderbolt speeds. Because look, if you're in the middle of editing some photos or some videos, for instance, or transferring some files and you need to charge, that's just not gonna work, right? To just have that one port over here. So honestly, I think it remains a bit of a tough choice here. If you wanna save over $100 and that's your main goal, I really don't think you're gonna be disappointed with the Combo Touch. It is super enjoyable, all the more so with this fixed trackpad and with this slimmer design. And while the Magic Keyboard doesn't have a stand mode that you can detach the keyboard from, it doesn't have the function keys, it's still the top of the pack when it comes to the actual typing and this trackpad experience. One final observation though for you. I feel like the Magic Keyboard offers a little bit more of an immersive iPad experience overall versus the Combo Touch. And the reason is simple. It's because this design puts the iPad physically closer to your face than does the Combo Touch. And that has to do with Apple's quote unquote floating design here. By nature, the iPad itself kind of sticks out over the keyboard and lets it get a little closer. Whereas the Combo Touch, when I switched over to that, it felt further away. I noticed that difference. And it's gotta be only like centimeters or something, but it really made a big mental impact on me how much further away the iPad seemed. And I feel like it has to be intentional on the Apple engineers' part to have put that closer to your face. It wasn't just about the looks. I really can appreciate that when I'm using the Combo Touch here. Now, the other part of the equation is it depends how far you like to have the screen push back, what angle you're at. So it's nice that this can go back further, but the further you push it back, you know, the more tricky it might be to use the Face ID, for instance. I feel like the Face ID struggled a little bit more in certain situations with the Combo Touch versus the Magic Keyboard. Again, just because my face was a little closer with the Magic Keyboard. Now, I'm not sure if you guys caught it, but I actually did a video just the other day. There's kind of a supplemental video, a follow-up to my iPad Pro's unboxing video where I talked about if you could use the old Magic Keyboard with the new iPad Pro. In other words, if you get the new iPad Pro, do you have to spring for a brand new Magic Keyboard, which is kind of what all the news articles were making it out to be. So if you're curious about that, I'll link that video up, it's real short, down in the description for you as well. All right, that's it for this video. Thanks for hanging out. More iPad content, more in-depth iPad content coming up soon. In fact, I need your help for the iPad Pro review. Give me your suggestions down in the description for specific apps and specific tasks like workflows within those apps that you want me to test on the 2 terabyte maxed out RAM iPad Pros. So one suggestion from somebody, for instance, to get you thinking was how many layers can you have open in an app like Procreate or Affinity Photo? Oh, and you know what? If there's another keyboard that you want me to check out, I know I probably have several others already incoming. Let me know specifically in the comments which one you'd like to see a review of or comparison of. All right, that's really it for this video. Don't forget to subscribe to the podcast. Get yourself subscribed for all my future iPad content, and I'll catch you in the next one. Later.